So you've electrophoresed the proteins down a gel, you've placed the gel on a nitrocellulose or PVDF membrane and transferred the protein from the gel to the membrane so that you can probe it with a specific antibody. You probe with a specific antibody or two, and the antibody is a protein, so there's no way to physically visualize it to detect it. So these antibodies are often coupled to other reagents to allow you to be able to detect it. They may be coupled to a fluorophore, a fluorescent molecule, so you can detect it using laser, or it may be coupled to enzymes such as alkaline phosphatase or horseradish peroxidase, and in this case, by supplying a substrate for the enzyme, a reaction will happen that you can visualize, you can detect. In the past, radioisotopes were also extensively used. So once you've detected your antibody or your protein via the antibody, you want to go ahead and quantify. Usually you want to compare it, or you just want to be able to convert the what you see visually to a numeric value that you can then manipulate and analyze. Then analyze and compare. So that's what we're doing, and there are several softwares out there. The free one that I'm going to be showing in this video is ImageJ. So to use ImageJ, the first thing you do is to go to the website and download it for free if you don't already have it. There is a version that comes with all these additional plugins that you may want to use for doing other analyses, like if you have a lot of images from a microscope. Then the FIJI version has the plugins that's packaged with it. That would be easier. But for just doing Western blot analysis, it's fine to just have ImageJ. So here's an overview of ImageJ and what you can expect from the program. So in ImageJ, you've got these options at the top. So you have your file where you can open your document that you want to edit, the gel image that you want to quantify. You've also got edit where you can clear things or undo things that go wrong. Then you've got your image, and this is where you can sort of rotate, where you can adjust the brightness and contrast. And this is just for the visuals. It doesn't actually affect the intensity. So it doesn't actually affect the actual ratios and the intensity. So it's okay. You can do that in ImageJ. That's not true for other software. So in image, you can also have things like transforming the image, so you may want to flip horizontally or rotate it a little bit just to get the bands to line up properly for when you're going to measure the intensities of the bands. So you know that some membranes, if you want to compare two membranes at the same time, for instance, it may not be perfectly aligned, so you can use that to just adjust the alignment of it. Analyze, you can get things like measure where you will be, you can get set the measurements that you want, and you can have some plugins. So then there's the toolbar. So this is the main toolbar where you'll be selecting the kinds of tools that you want to draw around your images. You have the rectangular one, which tends to be the main one that we'll be using. Then you have things like drawing the line. This is when you've got, anyway, we'll come to it, that comes in handy. Then the wand, which is used to trace around peaks that you draw, that you capture. So the first thing to do is to go and open the file that we want to edit. So just go ahead and file and open. Once you have your file open, then you can select the rectangular tool. And what you want to do is first just get the background that you want to use to subtract from your main image. So you could either select the whole lane here to use as your background. If this was an image where we had only stain for one protein, then everything else would be considered background. So we could actually just get the whole lane. Then we go to analyze, and we're going to say measure. So that's the measure is giving us an area, but maybe we want to tune that a little bit. We don't want the area. So we can go ahead and go back to analyze and set measurements. And here the default was that it was reporting the area, and it was giving me the minimum and max gray value and min and max. So I'm just going to get rid of everything. So I don't want the area, I don't want the min and max integrated density. And so in this case, it's going to show you the signal for the entire lane. So the first thing we need to do is just to invert the image into black and white. I know it already looks black and white, but we're going to put it on grayscale, and this allows the values that are black to be the background and those that stand out as white to be assigned some sort of quantitative value, some kind of numerical value. So that's what we've done here. And then you can just select the rectangular tool, which will allow you to select the band as well as the background. So I'm going to go ahead and just select for this first lane and select a background for each lane. Just find an area that I think looks like background. There's nothing happening. And what you want to do is go to analyze. There are two options that I've seen for doing this. It turns out doing the integrated density is the best option. So in analyze, we can go to set measurements. And in here, you can see you could select whether you want to measure the area, the standard deviation, the minimum and max. So I'm just going to take integrated density. So that's just to set what kind of measurement we want to make. I'm selecting this tool to be the same kind of size as what I would want to measure. It's a little bit difficult selecting the tool, but these are the width and heights of the band. So I'm going to use that same rectangle to get the background. And I find that if you're lifting it, you can sometimes stretch the size of it, and then it's really difficult to get back to the original size. If someone who's watching this knows how to not lose the how to go back to the rectangle size when you lose it, let me know, because when I go to undo, it doesn't affect the rectangle. So it's best to just use your arrows to navigate once you've drawn the size that you want. So I'm going to come on to this part, which I think looks like it's just background. And then I'm just going to go to analyze, and I'm going to just measure essentially. And so it gives me a value for that, for the density that it sees there. I'm going to go ahead and now select back into here, and I'm going to now measure the background for this lane as well. So I'm just going to go ahead and do analyze and measure. So I'm going to get all the backgrounds for each of the lanes that I'm going to be taking the bands, the measurements for, before I go ahead and actually measure the bands. And then I'll just be able to subtract the background away from the actual values that I get. Just come back, and that will be what we've done. All the values that have been recorded are just here. So we can just go to edit and select all, and then edit and copy. And then we can pop that into Excel and do the analysis there. So we're here in Excel. I've got a lane for my protein signal, then a lane where I'll factor in the background that I measured initially, and then I'll do a ratio of the bands, because these bands are all of different days. I'll just reference it to the initial day just to see what intensities are coming across. And then often once you do that, you may find that the numbers are a little bit harder to kind of read, in terms of, like, as humans, you know, we kind of like things in ones, two, threes, four, fives, or tens, or hundreds, as we do usually percentages, just to make things easier, to make meaning a bit more obvious for us. So it may be important to just normalize it. Two types of normalization can be performed. You would usually need to normalize to your loading control, just to make sure that the intensity of the band is representative of the lane, the amount of protein that was in the lane. So you can stain for total protein in the lane and then adjust the intensity of the band that you've measured accordingly. You may also want to do normalization where you adjust the scale, just so it's easier to get meaning out of the data at first glance. I have an article in the comments of this video looking at stain-free methods for normalizing your Western blots. Here we go. So I had copied it earlier, so we can just paste it here. And if you remember, the first 9 values were actually just values that were related to intensities that were related to the background for each lane. So I'm just going to use that for the first value. These backgrounds, these are the actual signals that go with those. So I'm going to copy that and just pop that into the protein signal, because that's the intensity that we got from the software. So for the background adjusted, I'm just going to go ahead and do this one. And so in Excel, you just do equals, and then I'm going to do this protein signal. I'm just going to take away the background that was for that lane to adjust for it and enter. And rather than do it separately, I'm just going to drag it all down and make sure that it's done the right thing by checking. So in here, it's done. This is done. This one minus this one, which is correct. That's what we told it to. And then in this, it's moved to this one, and then it's moved to the next background, which is perfect. We've got our background adjusted values here now. So the ratio of bands then. So if I want to see what this signal is in relation, well, this signal in relation to the first band, and just do it all in relation to the first band, I can just go ahead, and that's relative to each other. So we go ahead and let's say we make band one, the one that we want to scale everything to. So we just do band one divided by itself, and that gives us a value of one. And now we're going to have a look at everything else, all the other bands in reference to that. And so the way to do it, we can make this cell C2. That's where band one is. We can make that C2 the reference cell. And to tell Excel that that's the reference cell for all of these values, we go ahead and put a dollar sign in front of that reference, which is C2. So now when we drag down, you will see that it's referencing everything to C2. So let's take a look if it's done that. It looks like it has. So it went ahead and did this value, and it divided it by C2. So that's wonderful. That's what we want. And it's done the same. So it moved down to this cell, band 3, and it's divided it by C2 once again. And we go to the next, and it's done. Okay, so we can trust that it's done the right thing. And this straight away gives you a sense that, you know, this band 9, for instance, is almost 20% less than the first band in terms of integrate, in terms of density, so meaning less protein there. And so, you know, it's 90% to be precise. So we can do the percentages here then, which once again, normalizing makes it easier for us to get a sense of what's happening at a glance, because when it was like 3,000, 36,000, 34,000, it was, you know, you knew it was going down, but you weren't really sure how much, you know. But this one kind of tells you about 19%, you know. So let's put the percentages here then, and that will just make it easier once again. So that would just be simply this, and percentage just means per 100. So we just literally multiply by 100. Don't know what's happening here. Okay, so equals this one, and then we're just going to multiply it by 100. So that sets the first band as the standard to reference everything to. And so we've done that. So we see that, yeah, 81%. So we're losing 19% of the signal by the time we get to day 9 or band 9. And so we've gradually sort of lost signal. So that's that. And then, of course, you can plot it, which I will share with you in the next video. All the best with your Western blood.